And can we have Mike Forgeron come to the stage, please? And I'll tell you what, as Mike makes his way forward, let's just watch a little video, take you back to 1992 in Barcelona.
So we are just about set to go. The final race of the Olympic Rowing Regatta. And joining us here, a special treat for everybody, we have Silken Laumann, fresh from her magnificent bronze medal performance in the women's single sculls. We are underway now, and first of all, Silken, congratulations on your marvelous result just a little while ago.
Well, thank you very much. It was a difficult race, and I'm glad to have come out with the medal.
What do you think about the men's eights here as we get started?
Well, you can't underestimate anybody. I think it's going to be at least a three-boat race, maybe a six-boat race right across the line. So it's going to be a very, very tough race for the Canadians.
Roger, what about the start here? Always important, maybe more important in this race?
Well, my impression is that Canada is not satisfied with the start they've had in their first two races. They were beaten by Romania in the first race, and I think they were a bit surprised to get a bit behind. I'm hoping that they're going to have a much more powerful first 500 meters, and then they're going to really have to work through the middle 1,000.
In lane one, that's Australia. Next to them in lane two, the United States. Then it's Romania in the middle in lane three, Germany in lane four. Canada is out in lane five, rowing very well right now, and then Great Britain in lane six. This Canadian team, John Wallace, the man in Silken's life. We also have Bruce Robertson, Mike Forgeron, Darren Barber, Robert Marland, Mike Rasher, Andy Crosby, Derek Porter, and the coxswain, Terry Paul. And Canada is looking good out there in lane five.
They look like they're in a good position. They've got a good start, and they just got to pull away right here.
It's Canada in lane five and Romania in lane three right now, and the German team in between. The Canadian men's eights rowing hard right now, looking strong.
You can see the effort on their faces. They're really going for it now.
Silken, what goes through your mind at this point in a race?
Well, it hurts a lot at the 750 mark, but you've got to really push hard, push through the pain, and try to get ahead of the pack.
You want to be ahead at the 1,000-meter mark. Is it that important to be ahead at halfway?
Well, you certainly don't want to have lost contact with the crews, and I think it's a psychological advantage to be a little bit out in front.
And Canada is a little bit out in front. Lane number five right there. Romania in lane three, pushing hard. All right, we're through the halfway point, past 1,000 meters, less than 1,000 meters to go. Canada has a slight lead over Romania, less than half a second. Germany is in third position. Australia currently running in fourth. A great race for the Canadian men's eighth so far, but this race is not over yet. We knew it would be close going in. It has been close, very close, through the first 1,000 meters. We've less than half a race to go. The Canadian men's eighth trying to make it five medals for Canada in this Olympic regatta. We already have gold. We already have bronze from Silken here. We're looking for another medal. Can we do it? The Canadian men's eights at the 1250 mark, still leading Romania. Canada, Romania, and Germany. Those three have seemed to spread it out a little bit and have opened up a lead on the rest of the field. It is the Canadian men's eights right now. We are approaching the 500 meter mark, or 1500 meter mark, 500 to go. Canada in front, Romania in second spot, Germany trying to hang on in third, but the Canadian eights are looking very strong now, almost a half a boat length lead on Romania.
They couldn't be in a better position, I don't think, in a race plan. Do you, Silken?
This is fantastic to be ahead, 500 meters to go. They're going to be really going for it. They've got a strong last 500. Here they go.
What happens to your body at this point, Silken?
Your muscles are screaming. You know there's only 60 strokes left in the race, and you're just putting that oar in as fast as you can with as much power as possible.
Canadian eights, Roger, go ahead.
I was going to say, they've got the gold medal in their minds, I'm sure, with
this
all the success.
Great.
The women's eight won the gold, and they want to do the same thing. They're half a boat length out.
We are at the 250-meter mark. Way to go, Silken. The 250-meter mark to go. Canada, the Canadian eights are still in front. Romania
44.
And Germany very close for second. The Germans, I think, are moving up a little bit,
yes,
Silken.
Yes, they are moving up a little bit. They're dangerous right now, but I think that Canada has still a little bit in them. They've just got to lift that rate a little bit more.
The Canadian men's eights looking to make it four gold medals for Canada in the Olympic rowing regatta. They're looking strong, Roger, their stroke rate.
20 strokes to go.
They're around 39, 40 strokes, with 20 strokes to go.
The last 50 meters, the Canadian eights. Romania now with a final push. Romania coming strong. Go, Canada. Can they hang on? They are there. They have just a few meters. Yes! Gold medal!
Well, that was Barcelona, 1992, a network I read here called CTV that did the Olympics. I want to introduce you to one of three Nova Scotians ever to have won a gold medal at the Olympic Games. Two years ago, we inducted Al McGuinness, a gold medal-winning Canadian hockey player from Port Hood. Sometime in the future, Sidney Crosby, a hockey gold medalist last winter. If he continues to perform well and behave himself, he might be inducted into the Nova Scotia Sport Hall. And tonight, another Cape Breton Olympic gold medalist enters the hallowed hall. The only Nova Scotian to have won a gold at the Summer Olympics, Mike Forgeron of Manadou on the Myra Bay, a few kilometers from Louisbourg. He grew up, he'll tell you, in a rowboat. Well, just a little guy, he helped row his dad, Ted, a fisherman, back and forth to and from their fishing boat, thus learning the rudiments of a sport that would eventually take him around the world, not by rowboat, and to a gold medal performance in Barcelona in 92. Mike said recently, quote, "When I went to the University of Western Ontario, I discovered rowing could be a competitive sport, and they had a great rowing program. I knew of the rich rowing heritage of my home province and knew it would be a good fit for me." Well, good it was. Good enough to take him to the World Rowing Championships, the World Student Games, Commonwealth and Pan American Games, and two Olympics. Good enough for Mike to be recognized with awards of recognition by the Nova Scotia Rowing Association, Nova Scotia Department of Sport and Recreation. Good enough to be named Nova Scotia Male Athlete of the Year in 1993. And to be elected to the Canadian Amateur Sport Hall of Fame in 1994, good enough to receive a Rowing Canada Award of Merit in 1993 for his contribution to the sport as an athlete and administrator in athletic development, and certainly good enough to receive a Governor General Commemorative Medal in 1992. Even when he was feted with a parade from the Sydney Airport to his hometown after the 1992 Olympics, where the road was lined with people holding signs of recognition and cheering him for his gold medal feat, he remained humble, as he is today. In an interview with the Cape Breton Post after being elected to the Nova Scotia Sport Hall of Fame, Mike was quick to shun personal glory. Must have been a Romanian fan from 92. Sorry. They were too good. Darn Romanian fans, huh? Sad. Mike said, "Every effort is not only by the people in the race, but by all the people who support you, make it possible for you to train, to perform like you have to win. I'm always the point guy for this stuff because I'm the guy in the race, but there's a lot of people who share in it." Adam Parfitt, national team coordinator with Rowing Canada, rode with Mike in the Pan Am and Commonwealth Games in 1994. In an interview from Vancouver, Adam said, "Mike was a leader, calm and confident, which was reassuring for a young rower. In the boat at the Pan Ams and the Commonwealth Games, he was a leader in the boat. He'd been there. I was nervous, but he kept all of us in line. For him, it was like a day at the office. His attitude was, let's just get it done." Mike is proud the Olympic gold medal has had an effect on people he's met since the glorious win. He says, "It certainly shaped people I've met and worked with as they admire the accomplishment, but has also enabled me to advance in life as well." He admits his rowing career started slowly. In his first year at Western, he was 21st of 22 boats. In his second year rowing with the club program, he moved to halfway up the standings. In his third year again, he moved up half again to seventh. And after that, he was always in the top two. Mike Spracklin, head coach of the national men's team, recalls Mike's initiation to rowing. In an email interview for tonight, he reported that Mike Forgeron's rise to fame was unique in that he won an Olympic gold medal with no previous experience at international levels. "We did race in Essen, Germany early in the season, but with sickness in the crew, could race only once and below par for the crew. I saw him row in a pair in London, recognized his potential, and he came to Victoria Training Center less than 1 year before Barcelona. Going from a one-session-a-day college program to a three-times-a-day national team program was a huge step, but Mike showed tremendous resilience. His quick adaptation to the high-intensity program was impressive. He was receptive to coaching, and his pleasant disposition made it easy for a coach. Mike Forgeron says the difference between success and lack thereof is that achieving different milestones in the sport, or any sport, require different levels of effort. The Olympic champ here admits, he says, you certainly have to work and have to prepare to compete internationally. Then you have to go even harder to be in the top 10 and work incrementally more with additional resources to make the last jump to the top. Well, this man, as you know, reached the top. It's evident he was never afraid of hard work, always believed in training, and admits he never overcomplicated things. Adam Parfit says, while Mike took training seriously, he had perspective, a balance. He was certainly committed, but knew there was more to life than just rowing. I want to show you one more time here, the final leg of that gold medal race. This features some bonus footage too, so sit back and enjoy this.
Really going for it. They've got a strong last 500. Here they go.
What happens to your body at this point, Silke?
Your muscles are screaming. You know there's only 60 strokes left in the race, and you're just putting that oar in as fast as you can with as much power as possible.
The Canadian eights. Roger, go ahead.
I was going to say, they've got the gold medal in their minds, I'm sure, with
this
all the success.
Great.
The women's eight won the gold, and they want to do the same thing. They're half a boat length out.
We are at the 250-meter mark. Way to go, Silke. The 250-meter mark to go. Canada, the Canadian eights are still in front. Romania
44.
And Germany very close for second. The Germans, I think, are moving up a little bit,
yes,
Silke.
They are moving up a little bit. They're dangerous right now, but I think the Canada has still a little bit in them. They've just got to lift that rate a little bit more.
The Canadian men's eights looking to make it 4 gold medals for Canada in the Olympic rowing regatta. They're looking strong, Roger, their stroke rate.
20
they're
strokes to go.
They're around 39, 40 strokes with 20 strokes to go.
The last 50 meters, the Canadian eighth. Romania now with a final push. Romania coming strong. Go, Canada. Can they hang on? They are there. They have just a few meters. Yes! Gold medal! And now one more time. We never get sick of hearing it. For the Canadian men's eights, oh, Canada.
So, folks, there he is, our newest inductee into the athlete category of the Nova Scotia Sport Hall of Fame, Mike Forgeron.
Can you stand up and wave? They're going to come give you a
I'd like to invite to present the certificate Stephanie O'Connor, who is a Nova Scotia Sport Hall of Fame board member, and to present the pin, Mike's dad, Ted. This is the guy that showed his son the rudiments of rowing and encouraged him to become a gold medalist. How cool is that to get the pin from Dad, huh?
That's perfect.
Yeah. Couldn't be better, right? To take us back, we hinted at it in the story, but you're a little guy, you're growing up, and you actually row with Dad to help him get to work, right?
Yeah, row out to the boat. Yeah, it's fantastic.
And that was the introduction to it, huh?
That was the introduction to it. In Manitou, I grew up on the water. So I grew up in boats from the time I was small. So it was a transition to learn how to row one of those skinny little things, but it went okay.
It seemed to go just fine. Quickly now, let's go to Western for a moment. 21st out of 22 boats your first year, and you gradually move up. How do you keep from being discouraged, and what drives you to get better every year?
Yeah, it's a bit odd like that, I guess, because they. I was lucky because you find people that, like you say, everything that we talk about here is not just a singular effort. You know, there's people behind you all the time. The first time I tried out for the national team, I was, 21st at a 22nd. But that was a step up. So so I thought next time it's going to be better.
At least 20. At least 20, easily. You watch that footage. That footage is just great. And one of those camera angles is bad because it looks like Romania's pulled ahead of you, right? And then they switch to the overhead and it's okay. But Silk and Lauman tried to articulate it. Articulate the pain coming down the stretch.
It's hard because it's hard to articulate, you know, because it's a 5.5 minute sprint. So because of the length of the race, you can almost go full out for the whole thing. So what happens is your muscles fill up with lactic acid, and that's what kind of stings, and they stop working so well towards the end of the race. So it takes a lot of training to get to the point where your body can move lactic acid and kind of work through it. And we'd done so much training that we were confident in our conditioning in the last half of the race, and that's what let us try and get out ahead there with a quarter of the race left to go, to try and put on a bit of a push where we thought people might not quite expect it.
Hey, men's eights and Canada seem to do pretty well come Olympic Games. Why is that boat in particular so successful at Olympics?
I think it's because there's a history of it. You know, people have seen it be done before, and they realize that it's possible, so they go after. I mean, that's kind of the bar. Right, so that's what folks go after. That's what you chase.
Final one for you. Are you still heavily involved in the sport?
I'm lightly involved in the sport. I do it to try and stay a little fit. I offer, you know, free advice to folks when they don't want it, that kind of thing. You know, so
that's the beauty of retirement, right?
Yeah.
Folks, this is our newest inductee, a gold medalist, only Nova Scotian ever to win it at a Summer Olympics. Mike Forgeron.